Dear children, today we are going to learn a chapter in your biology syllabus. Before that, I will ask you to list certain factors by which you can say things are alive or not. You will say that living things show some of the living characteristics like growth, movement, and respiration. Some of the internal factors like digestion, transportation, excretion, reproduction, also you say. So what do you call all these processes? So all these processes together are called life processes. Life processes are the processes by which living organisms survive and maintain their functions. In this chapter, we will going to learn four important life processes: nutrition or digestion, respiration, transportation and excretion. Although you have learned digestion and respiration in your A standard, let us have a quick look at these two processes, namely digestion and respiration. See, digestion in another words is called by life process called nutrition. See, what is nutrition? Living organisms will take in food to get the energy. So this is called nutrition, the process of obtaining energy by taking in the food is called nutrition. So here nutrition will be obtained by all the three types of living organisms, namely microorganisms, plants and animals. See, microorganisms, they are unicellular, having a single cell inside them, so they will be directly exposed to the outer environment. So the oxygen or carbon dioxide or the food will be directly coming into their body by a simple process called diffusion. But in higher plants and animals, the process is not simple as that. So it needs a complicated organ systems. Plant needs a complicated shoot and root system, whereas animals need a complicated organ systems like digestive system, respiratory system, transportation system, like that. So when coming to the plants, see, plants with the help of their leaves will be producing the food in the form of carbohydrates. By a process called photosynthesis, plants obtain the sunlight with the help of the chlorophyll pigment present inside the cells of the plants, and with the carbon dioxide, so they prepare the food in the form of carbohydrate. These are the stomata you can see here. So when you take a cross section of the leaf, you see the structure like this: upper epidermis, lower epidermis, and then the epidermis will be having a stomatal pore. See, this stomata is magnified here. So this stomatal pore receives the carbon dioxide, and that carbon dioxide is taken inside with the help of the chlorophyll pigment, and by trapping the sunlight, it produces the food. So this is called autotrophic mode of nutrition, where plants prepare their own food by taking the raw materials like carbon dioxide, water and sunlight. So they produce oxygen and also food in the form of carbohydrate. So when you come to the nutrition in higher animals, for example in human beings, the food will be taken inside the mouth in the whole quantity. So that this type of nutrition is called holozoic nutrition. See, this holozoic nutrition is seen in the human beings. So when the food is taken inside the mouth, there will be teeth and tongue. With the help of that, food is chewed and the salivary gland produces the saliva consisting of the salivary amylase. Salivary amylase is an enzyme reaches the stomach. So in stomach, so there will be certain things like hydrochloric acid and pepsin. Together constitute the gastric juice. So gastric juice consisting of the hydrochloric acid and pepsin helps in the digestion of the food further. So hydrochloric acid provides an acidic media to the food, which in turn helps the pepsin to become active. So this pepsin helps in digestion of the proteins very little extent. So after the food mixed with the gastric juice and partly digested comes to the small intestine. So while coming to the small intestine, food will be mixed with the secretions from the liver and the pancreas. See, in liver there will be bile salts.
Let us learn this chapter life processes by following these slides. The processes in which living organisms perform maintenance functions are called life processes. In lower organisms, a process called diffusion is sufficient to carry out all the life processes. But in multicellular organisms like human beings, it needs a complex body design. So it has got special organ system. So what is the criteria for living organisms? A visible movement such as walking, breathing or growing is generally used to decide whether something is alive or not. Presence of a life process is a fundamental criteria that can be used to decide whether something is alive or not. An organism uses outside raw materials mostly in the form of food and oxygen. The raw materials required by an organism vary depending on the complexity of the organism and its environment. In this chapter, we are learning four important life processes, namely nutrition, respiration, transportation, and excretion. The reproduction life process will be learned later in separate chapter. To learn the first life process, digestion or nutrition, the definition goes like this. The process of obtaining energy through consumption of food is called nutrition. in a type of nutrition called autotrophic nutrition. In this, an organism prepares its own food called autotrophic nutrition. Green plants and blue-green algae are examples of autotrophs. So photosynthesis is the process by which autotrophs take in carbon dioxide and water from the outside and convert them into carbohydrates in the presence of sunlight and chlorophyll. Here is the chemical equation of photosynthesis. 6 molecules of carbon dioxide combines with 12 molecules of water in the presence of chlorine and sunlight to form 1 molecule of glucose C6H12O6 and 6 molecules of oxygen. When we look at the steps of photosynthesis, at first one, absorption of light energy by chlorophyll takes place. In the second step, conversion of light energy to chemical energy and splitting of water molecules into hydrogen and oxygen. In the third step, there will be reduction of carbon dioxide to carbohydrates. See, how is the photosynthesis taking place in desert plants? Desert plants take up carbon dioxide at night and prepare an intermediate which is acted upon by the energy absorbed by the chlorophyll during the day. So what are the raw materials for photosynthesis? Water comes from soil through the xylem tissue in roots and stems. Carbon dioxide comes in the leaves through stomata. So you are looking at the cross section of a leaf lamina. In that you are seeing chloroplasts, the green dots like cell organelles which contain chlorophyll, and in that you are observing stomata. These are tiny pores present on the surface of the leaves. So what are the functions of stomata? Those are exchange of gases like oxygen and carbon dioxide, and a process called transpiration where plants lose large amount of water in the form of water vapor. In stomata, you are seeing bean-shaped cells called guard cells. So what does guard cells do? The function of guard cells is to regulate the opening and closing of stomatal pore. So how is stomatal pore controlled? The guard cells swell and water flows into them, causing the stomatal pore to open. Similarly, the pore closes if guard cells shrink. How does stomata act in desert plants? In desert, temperature is very high, so stomata are closed to reduce the loss of water due to transpiration. Desert plants are adapted to take up carbon dioxide at night when stomata are open. The carbon dioxide taken up in the night prepares an intermediate compound which is acted upon by the energy absorbed by the chlorophyll during the day to prepare food. So here is an experiment to demonstrate that sufficient quantity of carbon dioxide is necessary to carry out the process of photosynthesis. Here, why is potassium hydroxide is placed inside the pot? So potassium hydroxide is kept to absorb the carbon dioxide in the bell jar. Vaseline is applied to make the setup airtight. Here, since the potassium hydroxide is kept inside the pot, so it absorbs all the carbon dioxide. Because of that, unavailability of carbon dioxide makes the leaves not to prepare the starch. So this gives us the importance of carbon dioxide. So what is the importance of nitrogen to the plants? Nitrogen is an essential element used in the synthesis of proteins and other compounds. It is obtained from the soil in the form of organic nitrates or nitrates, or it is taken up as organic compound which has been prepared by bacteria from atmospheric nitrogen. In another type of nutrition called heterotrophic nutrition, organisms are dependent on other organisms for their food requirement is called heterotrophic nutrition. That will be taking place in animals, fungi and bacteria. So another mode of nutrition called saprophytic mode of nutrition, organisms will break down the food materials outside the body and then absorb it. So these animals are called saprophytes. For example, fungi like bread molds, yeast and mushrooms. So how do these saprophytic organisms like mushrooms will obtain their food? Organisms like bread molds and mushrooms break down the food materials outside the body and then absorb it. So in higher animals like human beings, a type of nutrition called holozoic nutrition is seen. A type of nutrition in which organisms take in whole material and break it down inside their body is called holozoic nutrition. In another mode of nutrition called parasitic mode of nutrition, organisms derive nutrition from plants and animals without killing them. For example, cuscuta, orchids, ticks, lice, leeches and tapeworms. Here you can see the difference between saprophytic and holozoic mode of nutrition. So nutrition in amoeba, so it takes place with the help of pseudopodia, which fuse over the food particle forming a food vacuole. Inside the food vacuole, complex substances are broken down into simpler ones, which then diffuse into cytoplasm. The remaining undigested material is thrown out. So in paramecium, which is a unicellular organism, the cell has a definite shape and food is taken in at a specific spot. Food is moved to this spot by the movement of cilia, which cover the entire surface of the cell. So this is the diagram of paramecium, where the food taken inside can be absorbed here. Coming to the digestive system of human beings, it has got a long alimentary canal. The long tube extending from the mouth to the anus is called alimentary canal. So when the food is taken inside the mouth, the teeth and tongue helps in chewing the food and is mixed with saliva secreted by the salivary gland. So what is the function of saliva? Let us see later the function of saliva. The lining of the alimentary canal is soft. The food we eat must be wetted to make its passage smooth. This is achieved by mixing with food with saliva secreted by the salivary gland. The saliva contains an enzyme called salivary amylase that breaks down starch, which is complex molecule, to give a sugar. After chewing in the mouth, the food is moistened and passed through the food pipe or the esophagus. There it undergoes a movement called peristaltic movement. Peristalsis is the contraction and relaxation of the muscles of the digestive tract to move the food through the digestive system. So after peristaltic movement, the food reaches the stomach. So in stomach, there will be two types of secretions. One is hydrochloric acid and another is an enzyme called pepsin. The function of hydrochloric acid is to make an acidic medium inside the stomach which is necessary for the action of gastric enzyme like pepsin. The hydrochloric acid kills most of the harmful bacteria. So when hydrochloric acid is secreted inside the stomach, will it not burn the stomach? Definitely no. The mucus protects the inner lining of the stomach from the action of acid. However, if the acidic secretions are more, then acidity will be there. Acidity is the condition when there is excess secretion of acids in the gastric glands of the stomach. So what will happen if mucus is not secreted by the gastric glands? If mucus is not secreted by the gastric glands, it will lead to erosion of the inner lining of the stomach, causing excessive acidity, ulcers and discomfort, as mucus protects the inner lining of the stomach from the action of hydrochloric acid. So how is the small intestine in herbivores? Herbivores will eat grass, so they need a longer small intestine, which allows the cellulose to be digested. Whereas carnivores need a shorter small intestine. Since carnivores eat meat, meat is easier to digest. Hence, carnivores have a shorter small intestine. So when the food is mixed with the hydrochloric acid and pepsin, the food having the protein part will be digested by that enzyme called pepsin. So it comes to the small intestine for further digestion. So bile juice from the liver and pancreatic juice from the pancreas will be mixing with the food in the small intestine. Fats are present in the form of large globules in the small intestine. The small intestine gets the secretions in the form of bile juice and pancreatic juice respectively from the liver and the pancreas. The bile salts break down large fat globules into small globules so that pancreatic enzymes can easily act on them. So small intestine receives the secretions from liver and pancreas. Small intestine is the site of complete digestion of carbohydrates, proteins and fats. How is the acidic food received from the stomach made alkaline in the small intestine? The food coming from the stomach is acidic and it is made alkaline for the pancreatic enzymes to act by bile juice from the liver. Function of bile juice secreted by the liver. Bile juice makes the food coming from the stomach alkaline. It increases the efficiency of enzyme action by breaking down the fat into smaller globules. How would digestion of food be affected if bile duct is completely blocked? If the bile duct is completely blocked, bile juice will not reach the small intestine and the digestion of fats will be affected. So, function of pancreas. Pancreas secretes pancreatic juice which contains the enzyme trypsin for digesting proteins. It also produces the enzyme lipase for the breaking down of emulsified fat. To differentiate between the enzymes pepsin and trypsin, pepsin acts in stomach while trypsin acts in small intestine. Pepsin acts in acidic medium while trypsin acts in alkaline medium. How would digestion of food be affected if pancreatic duct is completely blocked? If the pancreatic duct is completely blocked, pancreatic juice will not reach the small intestine and the digestion of carbohydrates and proteins will be affected. function of intestinal juice. The enzyme in intestinal juice converts proteins to amino acids. It also converts complex carbohydrates into glucose. It converts fat into fatty acids and glycerol. The inner lining of the small intestine has a numerous finger-like projections called villi. How does villi help in absorption of food? The inner lining of the small intestine has a numerous finger-like projections called villi, which increase the surface area for absorption. The villi are richly supplied with blood vessels, which take the absorbed food to each and every cell of the body. You can see here the finger-like projections called intestinal villi. The final product produced after digestion of carbohydrates is glucose and proteins. And proteins are amino acids. Absorption of digested food in small intestine. Digestion of food is completed in the small intestine. Inner lining of small intestine have numerous finger-like projections called villi, which increase the surface area for absorption. Walls of the intestine have blood vessels for carrying the absorbed food to different parts of the body.
Students, we will go to learn another important life process, that is respiration. So in microorganisms, there is a single cell. So the air consisting of the oxygen comes inside the cell through the cell membrane and diffuses into it. So there is a simple process called diffusion, which helps in performing the respiration. Whereas in plants, you have already known that the stomatal pore is the site of for exchange of gases, where carbon dioxide comes in and oxygen goes out. So in the living organisms, higher living organisms like human being, the respiration process is having a complicated way. You are seeing the respiratory organ called lungs here. So in the lungs, you are seeing the different parts: nasal passage, mouth cavity, pharynx, larynx, trachea, lung, bronchi, bronchioles, ribs, alveolar sac. So before that, children, we are going to learn how the different types of respiratory processes take place inside the living organisms. See, the respiration means the glucose, with the help of the oxygen, is broken down to give or release the energy along with the carbon dioxide. So here, glucose gets broken down to formin pyruvate. So pyruvate, again, it will be of three types. So pyruvate, in the presence of oxygen, in the lack of oxygen, and in the absence of oxygen, how it will be converted. So let us see. See, pyruvate, so in the absence of oxygen, transforms to form the ethanol, carbon dioxide energy. So glucose converted into pyruvate, and in the lack of oxygen is converted into lactic acid and energy. Whereas pyruvate in the presence of oxygen is converted into carbon dioxide, water and energy. See, in the absence of oxygen, respiration takes place, means that is in the microorganisms like yeast. So in the, if the oxygen is lacking, so if there is a shortage of oxygen, means so in the muscles, there will be process of respiration, there will be production of lactic acids. Whereas in the presence of oxygen means the aerobic respiration. So the carbon dioxide, water and energy are formed. So coming to the respiratory process in human beings, the air consisting of oxygen enters through the nose, and from the nasal passage enters through the pharynx and then larynx and reaches the trachea. So trachea, here branch, get branched
let us learn in detail about the life process, respiration. The process by which a living being utilizes the food to get energy is called respiration. Respiration is an oxidation reaction in which carbohydrate is oxidized to produce energy. So what are the steps of respiration? Breaking down glucose into pyruvate. This step happens in the cytoplasm. Glucose molecule is broken down into pyruvic acid. Glucose molecule is composed of 6 carbon atoms, while pyruvic acid is composed of 3 carbon atoms. So what happens to pyruvic acid? Further breaking down of pyruvic acid takes place in mitochondria, and molecules formed depend on the type of respiration in a particular organism. The 3 carbon molecule formed by the breaking down of glucose is called pyruvate. The process of breakdown of glucose in absence of oxygen is called anaerobic respiration. In this process, small amount of energy is released. So glucose is broken down to 3 carbon molecule called pyruvate. The pyruvate is converted into ethanol and carbon dioxide in anaerobic respiration. Aerobic respiration is the process in which glucose is completely broken down into carbon dioxide and water in the presence of oxygen. Glucose is broken down into 3 carbon molecule called pyruvate using oxygen. Pyruvate breaks down to give 3 molecules of carbon dioxide and water in aerobic respiration. You can observe the differences between aerobic respiration and anaerobic respiration. Aerobic respiration takes place in the presence of oxygen, whereas anaerobic respiration takes place in the absence of oxygen. In aerobic respiration, end products are carbon dioxide and water, whereas in anaerobic respiration, end products are ethyl alcohol and carbon dioxide. So when there is a lack of oxygen in the muscle cells, pyruvate is converted into lactic acid, which is also a 3 carbon molecule. This buildup of lactic acid in the muscles during sudden activity causes muscle cramps. You can see here all the 3 processes where glucose is converted into pyruvate, and pyruvate will be converted into ethanol and carbon dioxide in the absence of oxygen, whereas lactic acid and energy in the lack of oxygen, and carbon dioxide, water and energy are produced in the presence of oxygen. Anaerobic respiration is an incomplete breakdown of glucose and produces less energy, so it is less efficient. So exchange of gases in plants. At night, there is a photosynthesis occurring, hence carbon dioxide is the major exchange taking place. During the day, carbon dioxide generated during respiration is used up for photosynthesis, hence there is no release of carbon dioxide. So we can see respiration in plants like this. Why are organs which absorb oxygen placed inside the body in terrestrial organisms? The structures that help respiration are very fine and delicate. To protect these organs, they are usually placed within the body. How does the nasal cavity help in respiration? Nasal cavity has a fine hair which filters the dust particles for the air passing through it. The passage is also lined with mucus which moistens to avoid friction and trap dust particles. Why do the walls of trachea not collapse when there is a less air in it? Trachea is supported by C-shaped rings of cartilage so the walls of trachea do not collapse. Within the lungs, the passage divides into smaller and smaller tubes which terminate in balloon-like structures which are called alveoli. The alveoli provide a surface where the exchange of gases can take place. How is oxygen delivered from lungs to tissues? Blood brings carbon dioxide from the rest of the body for release into the alveoli. The oxygen in the alveolar air is taken up by the blood in the alveolar blood vessels to be transported to all the cells in the body. Why do lungs always have residual volume of air? The lungs always contain a residual volume of air so that there is a sufficient time for oxygen to be absorbed and for the carbon dioxide to be released. What advantage over an aquatic organism does a terrestrial organism have with regard to obtaining oxygen for respiration? Air contains more oxygen as compared to water. Terrestrial animals do not have to breathe faster to get more oxygen. How oxygen and carbon dioxide are transported in human beings? The hemoglobin pigment present in the blood gets attached to four oxygen molecules that are obtained from breathing. Oxygenated blood is then distributed to all the body cells by the heart. After giving away oxygen to the body cells, blood takes away carbon dioxide. Carbon dioxide is mainly transported in the dissolved form. Deoxygenated blood gives carbon dioxide to lung alveoli and takes oxygen in return. What happens if there is a deficiency of hemoglobin? Deficiency of hemoglobin in blood can affect oxygen supplying capacity of blood. This can lead to deficiency of oxygen in the body cells. It can also lead to a disease called anemia.